Hi friends, today we are going to discuss about pedigree analysis. Now pedigree analysis, that means the study of generations of family, and this is ideally done for any particular trait or any genetic disorder. If at all any of the individual is having, then his family history is checked. Or you know, there are chances if the family history, someone is having the disorder, the upcoming descendants, they might have that trait or that particular disease. So pedigree analysis is useful in humans as well as in domesticated animals. So when we discuss about pedigree analysis, the analysis of traits in a several generations of a family is called as pedigree analysis. Now pedigree, it is a chart which shows the record of inheritance of certain genetic traits for two or more ancestral generations of an individual or a domesticated animals. Now there are certain symbols which are associated with the pedigree analysis. There are some symbols which are used in pedigree analysis. This first symbol, a square, is denoting male. The round symbol, female. This symbol denotes the sex which is unspecified. If at all they are colored or darkly shaded affected individuals. The horizontal line between male and female denotes the mating or the marriage line. If two lines are present in between, then it tells us about the mating between relatives, which is also known as the contiguous mating. That means it is the mating or the marriages between relatives or the descendants which are from the same ancestors. Then the chart here, a little chart, it shows that parents above and their children below in order from left to right. So first female child and then the male child, and then comes the parents with the child which is been affected with the disease, because this is again the shaded box, and then the box where the unspecified sex is present, 5 offsprings are present, so it denotes the number of total individuals which are present. Now we are going to discuss about some symbols here. As we had already discussed about the pedigree symbols, there are some additional symbols too. If this is completely shaded, it is male or female, this is called as the solid symbol. And this solid symbol is a trait or any disease to be studied. Then, if it is the open symbol like this, this is called as open symbol. So it denotes the normal trait. If at all the symbol has cross or there are some lines present, then it denotes about the recessive allele. If at all there is a cross, so the one line cross in symbol, it denotes the death. Dot, if at all there is dot in the center, it is the carrier of sex linked trait. So it denotes the carrier of sex linked trait. So horizontal lines we have already studied about, it is the marriage line in between. If at all there is heterozygous condition, it is denoted by this. Half of the symbol is shaded or is darkened. So it denotes or it gives us the heterozygous condition of an individual. So these are the symbols which are very common and ideally used during pedigree analysis. Now pedigree analysis, it is ideally based on. Pedigree analysis is based on the first is principle of probability. So there are some facts on which the pedigree analysis is based. So one of them is principle of probability, then elimination of alternatives. The second is elimination of alternatives. Then the next is chances of differences in realized ratios. Then a recessive trait can appear in the progeny or it may be apparently present in the parent because they had been carriers. The next is recessive alleles are revealed more commonly in close marriages. So it is one of the important, if there are close marriages, the recessive alleles get accumulated and they can be seen in their upcoming progenies. A single pedigree analysis may not give the clear picture. In such cases, several independent pedigree analysis can be done so that the final conclusion can be taken. Now, there are some uses of this pedigree analysis, and the pedigree analysis is used for the extensive, or it can be extensively used in medical research. So medical research is one of the field where pedigree analysis can be used to study a particular trait. It provides information as to usefulness or harmfulness of marriages between close relatives. So if at all there are any marriages in between the relatives, usefulness and the harmfulness can be studied with the help of pedigree analysis. Then we can get the origin of trait in the ancestors. It may be the ancestor who are carrying it. So if at all the ancestors, they are the origin of that particular trait, that we'll come to know when the pedigree analysis is done. It provides information as to the possibility of a disorder in the progeny. So it helps us to detect if at all there are possibilities of getting any particular disease or trait in the upcoming progeny. Pedigree analysis is used in genetic counseling of prospective couples about the possibilities of transmitting a disease in the children. So this is all about the pedigree analysis, which helps us to know about our ancestors, about the recessive genes, if at all they are present in any family, and the upcoming results of that recessive or that particular trait, if at all it is present in the family history. Now we are going to discuss about mutation. Now see, mutation is a very big topic, so we need to take this quite seriously, because it will take a pretty little time to complete the topic mutation, because there are various types of mutation also, that also we are going to discuss. Today we are going to discuss about the basics of mutation, what exactly mutation is, who introduced, in general what happens, what are the types, mutation based on what things, morphology of mutation, what are the different aspects or basis of mutation. So first we are going to start with the definition of mutation. Any heritable change or a sudden change in a gene or chromosome which significantly changes the genotype and phenotype of an individual is called as mutation. So one thing we are supposed to remember here, whenever there is any change in the chromosome number, any change in the gene or its location, it gives very significant reaction on that individual, and that may be in the type of genotype as well as phenotype. Now, the mutation, the term was introduced by Hugo de Vries. Hugo de Vries, he introduced the term mutation. Now, mutation, that means it is the change suddenly in nature, in some of the populations, in few individuals from the population, if at all there is any change, that is considered to be the mutation. Then, Dobzhansky stated that mutation is a mistake or misprint in cell division. So during cell division, if at all there is any mistake which is done, or if at all there is any misprint which is done by the cell, then it is also called as mutation. Now there are various types of mutations. So in general, the mutations they are of two types. So the mutations, when the mutation is with respect to the chromosome, so any chromosomal mutation is called as macromutation. Any chromosomal mutation is called as macromutation. And if at all the mutation is with respect to gene, so that gene mutation are called as micro. Micro means very small. So they are called as micromutations. In general, the types or according to the chromosome or gene, the mutation is macromutation when it is related to chromosomal mutation, and it is micromutation when it is with respect to gene mutation. Now, more often, the term mutation is used for genes. For genes, mutation, chromosomal mutations, they are also called as chromosomal aberrations. This is very important to note here, that chromosomal aberrations, if at all there is macromutation, they are also called as chromosomal aberrations. Now, this chromosomal aberrations, we must have studied it about it, Down syndrome. So, Down syndrome, it is a 21 trisomy. So, if at all, any chromosome number, there is addition or deletion. For example, Klinefelter syndrome, for example, Turner syndrome. If the chromosomal aberrations are there, then they also lead to mutations. So, most of the time, the chromosomal mutations, they are also called as chromosomal aberrations. And in term of gene mutation, they are also called as point mutations. Point mutations, because most of the times, there is a single base pair. And because of the single base pair, or because of any particular amino acid coding gene, if it is get misplaced, then gene mutations can be seen. Now, mutations based, or the types, we can say mutations and their types. So where does exactly this mutation occurs? As we all know, human body, it has two types of cell. One is somatic cell and the other is germ cell. Somatic cell is present all over the body. Germ cell is present only in gonads, in the reproductive organs. So gonads, example is testes and ovaries. So if at all the mutation, it is in the somatic cell or it is in the body, then it is called as somatic mutation. And if at all it is present in the germ cell or in the gonads, then it is the germ cell mutation. Because ideally, when it is in germ cell, then only it will change the gene or genotype of that particular person, and then it comes into the next generation. Now, the next is mutation based on method of detection. So, mutation based on method of detection. So, it is characterized as morphological. Morphological, that means those involving alterations in external characters. So, morphology, we all know, the external features or external characters are known as morphology. So, if at all there is any mutation which involves the alteration in external characteristic, it is considered as morphological mutation. Then lethal genes, we had already discussed in sickle cell anemia, when the two recessive genes comes together and most of the time the individual dies. So that is considered as a lethal. So those genotype alterations which leads to death of an individual is known as lethal mutation. Then the next is biochemical. Biochemical, that means it is identified by a deficiency which can be overcome by supplying chemical compound for which mutant is deficient. For example, if any enzyme is not producing, then it can be given externally or it can be replaced. So that type of mutation is called as biochemical mutation. Then the next is resistant mutation. Ideally, it is identified by ability to grow in presence of an antibiotic like streptomycin, ampicillin, cyclohexymetine. These are some of the antibiotics, and some bacteria, they have the capacity to grow in certain antibiotic resistant, or they are the antibiotic resistant strains, because the alteration is done in the genes. So they are called as resistant mutations. Then the another one is conditional mutation. Now conditional mutation is those which allow the mutant phenotype to be expressed under certain conditions. So there has to be certain condition to be expressed. So if at all the condition is present, this type of mutations can be expressed. So such conditions are called as restrictive conditions, and normally which are called as permissive condition. So if at all the condition arises, the mutations can be seen. Now the next we are going to discuss about mutation on basis of occurrence. So depending how the mutation is being done, if the mutation is naturally without any interference in nature, it happens all of the sudden, then that is known as spontaneous mutation. Or if it is artificially done, if it is induced, then it is called as induced mutation. So on the basis of occurrence, if it is naturally occurring, then it is called as spontaneous mutation. And if at all it is artificially done, then it is called as induced mutation. Now there are some mutation procedures also. So the mechanism of gene expression will tell us about the fact of the sequence of amino acid or the enzymes, and this purely depends upon the sequence of nucleotides which is present on mRNA. Now for this, a very simple, the central dogma process we all know. So we'll discuss a bit of central dogma here. Central dogma is DNA has all the information in the form of codogens. So this DNA gives this information to mRNA, and mRNA carries it in the form of codons, and this mRNA help in the formation of proteins, or we can say amino acids. So the process from DNA to mRNA, it is called as transcription, and from mRNA to protein synthesization, it is called as translation. Now transcription means copying in writing. Whatever the information, it is present on DNA in the form of nucleotide bases. We know the bases A, T, G, C, adenine, thymine, guanine and cytosine. It is present in the form of codogens. Then this DNA gives this information to the mRNA, which is in the form of codons. Now remember one thing, since it is RNA, thymine gets replaced by uracil. So it is AUGC. So these are the triplets which carry information for production of particular amino acid. And when the particular amino acid is produced, it is known as translation. Now the main thing happens in between. For example, these codogens help in the formation of codons, and codons help in the formation of protein synthesis if at all mutation happens. Mutation happens in the DNA. So if at all any codogen gets added, deleted, or it has shifted its site, that is known as frame shift that we are going to discuss. The codons which mRNA carries will also get altered, obviously, because it carries all the information from DNA. And if codons get altered, ultimately the protein synthesization or amino acids will also get altered. So this is the main reason why the mutation occurs. And if at all it is a very significant change, then that change can be seen in the form of phenotype as well as genotype, which will affect that particular organism. So this is how the mutations can be done. And if it is very small, because most of the time the codons that we are going to discuss about, they are degenerates. That means more than 2 or 3 codons are there for a particular amino acid to be coded. And if it is a very minute change which is been done here, then nothing will happen. The mutation, even if it has been occurred, it will not show its effect on that individual. Hope it is clear. In our next lecture, we will study more about the types of mutations. Stay home, stay safe.